So, I'll probably reiterate a couple of things here compared to the first session, but they're supposed to be two separate standalone sessions. So, at least for the recording, I'll have to redo some stuff. Just notice that on this slide, I'm suddenly a development manager. But I'm Dave De Meijer. I'm working on the 3D and Docs product already for a long time. So this session is to get you guys to have a different look on deployment. That's one part of the presentation. And the second part is really examples and a lot of hands-on on what could business automation look like to get you guys inspired on some of the stuff. So there are two pieces in this. One for more the tools guys that handle deployments, and then the second part is for a knowledgeable technical writer even, so. In this part, it's about automation, and the thing that automation gives you is a lot of consistency. It gives you reliability, repeatability, things you need when you do deployments or when you try to do things over and over again. So, That is definitely a big thing to keep in mind when we talk about automation. Sometimes they talk about the geeky line that you do it manually until you cannot do it anymore and you want to automate it. But there are more reasons than just the manual part. The repeatability is not to be underestimated in today's world. The automation I'm going to show you is all about 3D and Docs Content Manager, also known as Knowledge Center. Live Content Architect, Trice of the InfoShare, and it's from the InfoShare, which is all over the code base, that you get the ISH abbreviation. So that's why all of our configuration files, modules, all that kind of stuff still works with ISH. So this will be about installation and business automation, and it's kind of also, a bit of it is a refresh of a webinar with it, I think, a year and a half ago or something like that. So what happens in a deployment? Kind of the classic deployment is you start with restoring a database, either one you get from professional services or the standard one, and then you install that server. And that server has some requirements, some prerequisites, because you want to have a certain Java version, either Adopto OpenJDK or the Oracle one, and so on. So there are prerequisites that need to happen. And then you run our install tool. So that takes that package, installs it on a box, and this is what you typically end up with. Then on that box, you also run database upgrade tool. Because install tool just touches that single web application server. That's really a design decision that it should not do more than that box. So it doesn't go and change stuff in the database. So that's safe for you guys. Database upgrade tool is the tool that makes the changes in the database and only in the database. And it can do the various kinds of changes. It can do the run some SQL queries, it can do updates on stored procedures, indexes, programmability, whatever is required, even legacy conversions we do in database upgrade tool. And that needs to happen. And then at the end, you actually have a working setup. Perhaps you still need to submit the settings and tweak something there, but that depends a bit on what the state of your database where you start with, but that's kind of you're working all in one box. And then as said, yeah, it depends a bit. Those left-hand side can be your front-end roles, and then there's back-end roles. And that's what I try to give you some guidance on how we think about those splits. And of course, we want all of this to be repeatable across development, test, acceptance, up to production, preferably. And even if it goes wrong, the disaster recovery is again part of that way of working and the And this is about the tools that we can offer you for automation. So when you would ask us the question like, how does it scale? Then I can highlight, so like you can have multiple servers, but even then, when you go deeper on a server, then we offer various kinds of roles, things that for us, I cannot call them microservices. That depends a bit on your definition of microservices, but at least they're standalone roles that you can enable, disable with a certain ease. So as said, if you have all the roles on one box, that's fine. What a lot of you have is a front-end box that offers those web interfaces and the web services. And then all of the other stuff is on a batch server, a back-end box. Perhaps multiple back-end boxes. So then we actually have a front-end box, and then a back-end single, and then back-end multi. The difference between the back-end single and the back-end multi is, for us, the back-end single contains the things you only want to do once. So there is one box for the full text index, and there is one box that knows how to run a database upgrade. Because if you have one database and you have five servers around it, you don't want to run database upgrade tool five times. You run it from one box, and we kind of put that role on a box which we call the backend single. So here you see how it flows. The backend custom refers to, yeah, if you have like referring back to publishing, which takes 24 hours and needs a Data Open Toolkit with 65 gigabytes of memory, then you probably want that separated out on a single box that has that 65 gigabytes of memory, and you could run a background task with a certain role that it can handle those certain messages there, and that not all of your boxes need to have whatever 60 gigabytes of memory, because that's not feasible in most organizations. As said, yeah, the singles, those are highlighted here as important. So if we do that deployment in a kind of pseudocode, then in the middle here, we start with setting up those prerequisites. And it's here that we offer two open source projects, and I'll come back to that in a little bit more detail later. Called ISH Server and ISH Bootstrap. That's on a single web application server. Then we have Install Tool, I think, which is well known. That's our installer for our installation package. And then we have ISH Deploy, and that can do customer-specific files. And we do that loop for all of those boxes, front-end, back-end. And then we have to do Database Upgrade Tool one time, the administrator's upgrade, so that's kind of also the settings inside the database. Think about workflow, think about users or plugins. You configure that once, and then you have a possibility there to run tests, to do quick checks if things are within your acceptance criteria. And then often, definitely on the beginning phases of development and test, you need to tune and fix. So you need to do this loop a couple of times. Once you get it stable, then there is actually the loop of reproducing this across the various phases of the product. So this is how you could theoretically look at the life cycle of deploying the product across the stages. And yeah, a lot of that information is even in workbooks or in quick manuals for people to give some guidance. And I think we can offer you some tools on automation. So on those various tools, I'll give a quick overview of what they are good at and what their non-functional requirements are. So Install Tool, I think, is the well-known one, because I think everybody used that. I want to highlight that there are three angles to it. So the ISH CD, where CD literally stands for compact disk from the old days, but we kept the name. That's the installation package. So that contains everything. And for many, it's prepared even with customer-specific files. So So those are files that kind of have the same structure as the original engineering delivered package, but that can override or enhance some folders with custom specific stuff. The install plan, that's the scenario. So in the scenario, it explains like you should set up an application pool in IIS, these Windows services need to be set up, and all that kind of stuff. And the input parameters, those are your actors. Those are specific for that box. A classic input parameter we calculate for you actually is the computer name, because it's different per box. But others are just the URL that you want to use, base URL. So it's command line driven, and it definitely offers those replayabilities, and it never touches your database. Database upgrade tool, it of course relies on an installation, and it has three phases. It does a pre-check, it does your changes, and then it does a post-check on your database, and sometimes it highlights like, hey, these are funny tables that I don't know about because something happened, but at least it gives you hints on that kind of stuff. So again, repeatability, and we don't see that as an extension point, so engineering owns database upgrade tool. So we test various upgrades paths from various versions in there, and the screenshot actually highlighted that there is a parameter where you can even force a re-upgrade across versions, but that's a detail. Then we have ISH Deploy. ISH Deploy is a PowerShell module, which has as a working scope, again, that single web application server. So it has the same working universe as install tool. And what ishdeploy does, it gives you commandlets to work with that system. And I'll show a little bit more demos later on. But for example, ishdeploy is the same across version 12, 13, 14. So you can use that as an API. But inside ishdeploy, we as engineering take responsibility. If for version 13, we only had to adapt 3 files, and for version 14, we have to adapt 7 files. That's our responsibility to enable some feature or not. For you guys, it's just, I want to enable this. And it's we that take the heavy lifting up there. So that actually means that those scripts written in ishdeploy can be used across multiple versions. Because it does actions which have to do with component services, Windows services, IIS, and all that, it is a Windows PowerShell library. It's not .NET Core or PowerShell Core, because that doesn't make sense at all here. For those who remember, we used to have that ishdeploy on GitHub, on our GitHub account, but we stopped doing that because it became a little bit difficult, and in the end we kind of control the whole library anyway. So we still keep the documentation public there about ishdeploy, and we deliver the signed stable released versions on the PowerShell gallery, which is very similar to like NuGet. It's the library online where you can download those modules. So if you are on a box, then you can, the most simple way, there are other ways, but the most simple way is to run install module ishdeploy from the PowerShell gallery that is owned by Microsoft. So on the right-hand side, you see what it looks like on the Microsoft website. One thing to highlight is in the beginning, we had specific versions of the library per, let's say, version of our content management software. That is now all simplified to one to rule them all. So there is no specific 12, 13, 14 edition anymore. It's one version to rule them all. ISH server. ISH server knows per version, like in this case, there is a module ish server 14. How, if you would install a brand new Microsoft box, Microsoft Windows server box, then it can has the automation inside of it that helps you to install third parties, prerequisites. It can set up that OS user with the right regional settings, and it has some helper functions even for firewalls and credentials. So it has all the things in there to simplify that prerequisite step. And we offer those releases on our GitHub account under the Ish Server project. So to give an idea, it knows in among these versions here that in version 13, it doesn't install MSXML4 anymore because that disappeared in version 13. The same with MSDTC, so Microsoft Distributed Transaction Coordinator requirements. Yeah, it also changed there, added some stuff along the way or support for a new Windows Server platform. So, but I cannot guarantee that they have exactly the same API because that depends on the things that change in the world. I think everybody saw that Oracle Java thing was not super easy with Java 8, Java 11 and all that. So we also have to comply with that. But it definitely looks alike across those versions. So it should be a lot easier starting point. And if you want to go further, then Ish Bootstrap goes to the next level because it holds enough actually to do a remote installation. So Ish Bootstrap allows you to use a Windows Core edition instead of Windows Graphical User Interface edition. So from a fresh box, Ish Bootstrap guides you through some dependencies of Ish Bootstrap. It can set up the Windows secure remoting for you if you want to. It downloads the prerequisites and uses Ish Server to install them. It can do some certificates if you want, the installation, customization. So it becomes a full pipeline of automation. That's what Ish Bootstrap gives you guidance on. And it's also available on our GitHub account. You can tweak it. We use it ourselves in our continuous integration pipeline for development.
You mentioned Windows Core. Do you mean Windows Core as the box that runs Bootstrap or the content manager actually running on a Windows Core server?
The content manager actually running on a Windows Core.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And in that pseudocode in the beginning, Ish Remote is the last one I want to highlight. Ish Remote is already a hint also to the second part of the session about business automation, but it's a toolkit, a PowerShell library that is fully on top of the public SOAP API. So it respects the whole authentication paradigm, and it can do anything that you actually can do in the web services API. So again, on GitHub, we will welcome contributions there as well. And it's a library that, where the API functions are available, works on the various versions of Content Manager. So it's something that most of you probably already can start with right now. But that's the cliffhanger for later. that is again also on the PowerShell gallery. So you can even do a local installation, that scope current user. So you don't have to be an administrator on your box. But you do need the rights to execute PowerShell code, of course. While Ish Deploy does require administrator because otherwise you cannot touch Windows services or that kind of stuff. So the deployment automation kind of try to sketch a lot of the things we have in our toolkit here. And I think the classic deployment style that a lot of people do is just run those prerequisites manually, perhaps take an image for an extra virtual machine or something like that, and then do the installation, where the installation often has those customer or project-specific files rolled in, and that if you have to change them later, it would require a full uninstall install to do it properly, or you just throw some files quickly on top and hopefully that that you don't forget that across your test acceptance production cycle. So a thing we offer through, the thing I'm trying to get you thinking about is that we think we are now at the stage where you can do a vanilla installation. So meaning you do the standard engineering installation without the customer specific files, using a standard install plan. And then using ishdeploy, you make that vanilla installation your customer specific deployment. Because that's the delta, and it's that vanilla box that you could actually take an image from and have it multiple times for your backend front ends or even across your DTAPS environments. So the crucial part here is the introduction of a commandlet called copy ish file, which is part of ishdeploy. And copy ish file understands that whole folder structure that I showed you previously, so the customer specific files folder structure. But it can also do the whole input parameters replacement. So it can, and it can do that over and over and over again, so it's idempotent. So you can run it 5 times in a row, it's the end result that matters, and not how you got there. So yeah, that's the hint that there is a moment where you could do imaging if you want. Definitely if you then really start to think about disaster recovery and all that, that speeds up a lot of the time. So what I'm mentioning here is the notion of a recipe. That's the term we use ourselves, so sharing it with you guys here. But that is the customization package. So it's a script that knows, given a certain vanilla installation, how to get to the project-specific installation. So, and that script, we're in automation, that script should be able to run on the various versions, and a lot of it is reused. If you go from a 13 SP2 to a 14, you might have to tweak a little bit that script, but the essence of it is 80-90% is the same. So, and once you put your script in source control, you have some traceability on why, when, what changed. So it gives you that DevOps mentality of getting everything structured and controlled. So the end goal of the recipe is to get to that working system, and it knows you should write that system as I start from a clean vanilla, but I can also do it idempotent. I can run it over and over again. So you need to write your checks in a way that it doesn't think that it can still resolve a halfway situation. So you have to be a bit smart about that. A lot of it is done with ishdeploy, of course, and in ishdeploy we do use the same rules. You can do the same statement 5 times in a row. It will not block you and say like, ah, no, I was already here, error. No, it just says, no, it's there. It's what you wanted it to be. Now, we have to be real. We took that route with ishdeploy already a couple of years ago, but we still have some technical debt that we need to fix. For some of you that worked with the classic ASP pages and customized those, well, over time we moved stuff in Metadata Config. But we still have a couple of those locations where we need to work on that and get rid of that. But so you still need that three-way compare to get stuff done and build up that customer-specific files folder. But we think it should become smaller, at least for our files. Most of you will definitely put in your custom DITA Open Toolkit, but that is yours anyway. That's not something we can really control. So, because it's a script, you can also do easier tests on it. So, if we remove a feature like Content Editor is no longer available in the 14 release, well, the script will show an error stating like the current version of Content Manager does not support Content Editor. So, you will get a hint at when running that script already in your development setup that something was wrong. So you should catch things earlier instead of late. And even a database upgrade tool and administrator upgrade can be part of those recipes if you respect those roles table that I shared in the beginning. So your recipe is configuration as code. So store it in a source control system. It should show the highlights of what has changed between major and patch versions. It can contain hotfixes for you. Those fixes that are also part of your project-specific files. So the most simple script that we can offer you is stop the deployment on the box. And that is a generic command that we offer for you that stops all of the processes of that deployment. And that means that you don't have file lock issues and whatever. So in your invoke recipe, you can copy the files you need and start your deployment, and it will start the things that were running before. So it knows what to restart. So this is the most simple script you can think of. Of course, we have more granular ones. If you want to stop the crawler service, then we can do that. Or if you want to stop the new collective spaces, we can do that. But yeah, this is the most simple one I could come up with. So I'll try to demo some of these things. I forgot to warm up my system because we have back-to-back demos. So this is my working system. So just gonna show you a property screen that it's on my local box, but I have to warm it up again. And it will show you the properties of the vanilla deployment. That's the idea. Okay. So I will show it later on again, but in here you don't see anything that says SDL products. That is the idea here. So I'm going to close this up. So this is a vanilla deployment. It works. And this is the demo script about this deploy, which I will post in a blog post somewhere that you guys can really see what I did and copy paste from that. So HDeploy offers a couple of read things to get you started. So one of them is it can print out the full input parameters that was used for this installation, except the passwords. So the calculated parameters, like I said, the computer name is all in there. It's the versions, it's all there. In your recipe, you can even ask to use specific ones, so you can find out what was the application path used and things like that. So there are parameters for all of them. You can find out exactly and drive your recipe to say, I want this or that to happen in that folder. So let's imagine the start of a recipe here. The first thing I'll do is I'll stop my deployment. And yeah, as I said, we're gonna add new review services. Stop is deployment knows everything it needs to stop for that particular version. So that happens. I have a folder here, which is something that a lot of you know. I'll quickly open it up here. But it contains some files, so applications. But in the websites, I want to highlight that I'm offering here a new metadata config file. And copy ISH file. With that source file, knows what it should do for this deployment. So it's now copying files. In my example, it's also copying a full DataOpen toolkit, so you have to give it a little bit of time. But yeah, imagine this after you imaged your thing, vanilla installation, we do a copy of these things, and it became a custom installation. So input parameters are replaced inside the file, just like install tool would. A little bit later here in this script.
Can you drill down into that more? Just do a single file?
You can copy file per file, yeah. So there are a couple of parameters, and in all honesty, preparing for the demo, I have another couple of ideas that should be added, but yeah. But the easiest way, you can actually state now, I want this folder to go in that folder. And if that folder then contains one file, then yes. So that happened. The services panel. So this is the services panel. We have still those services here. I hope you guys can see that. This by default, we set them to manual always, and they're running with the OS user InfoShare. That's my local OS user. I want to, on this box, and that's the role notion, I want these services to become enabled. So that happened. I'm on running a 14 edition, so this thing, content editor, no longer exists and will error out, as an example. But we also now introduce the collective spaces, in particular draft space, and that's something you can enable now in the user interface. So those buttons will now appear in the user interface. So this could be your recipe. Now, I hope it's not too difficult, but a recipe could contain more. But you also can think about this as a living system. So once you did an installation, there is still stuff that needs to happen. So for example, later down the project, you want to set up the installations, the integrations with SDL World Server or something like that. So I now activated translations export to the file system. But over here, there is a whole example on how to set up World Server that can be done here. Another thing that can happen on a living system is, oh, the database needs to be relocated. Where are my connection strings? And which ones do I have to adapt? Well, I have a working connection string here, which I can test. It says true. But I can now also run this commandlet, and it will change all of the places where we have a connection string. And you shouldn't care how many. We just change it for you. So that happened. The same with the OS user, which you set up at the beginning of the installation. As a reminder, it says InfoShare here. I'm now gonna replace it with another user, and I call them InfoShare 2. So I can run that. It asked me for a password. Even there are ways to do that, but I didn't necessarily want to show you passwords from our domain. And it does this thing on component services, the application pool, the Windows services, that all happens. So if I refresh this pane, it all reads InfoShare 2 here. So that's set, and the same goes for the others. So certificates expire, so you need to roll over. You can also do that. It's a little bit more difficult to demo, so I'm skipping that, but it's also in the documentation and some reference code here. In the end, my recipe, and you get the drift, there is a couple of stuff you can automate in a repeatable way. I can now start my installation. So it's starting up all the necessary services, and I think if I refresh this panel, you'll see some services have been set to automatic, and some of them are starting. In the meanwhile, I can show you that we have a couple of other nice commandlets. So there is the get deployment, like what did I really change now after the installation? Well, it says you changed your OS user, your connection string, your database user, the timestamps of when that happened, and even the source path changed. So that's actually the latest installation, because the install tool also knows how to uninstall your customer specific files. So you can also request like which scripts did I execute, which is more of a development thing. It's not necessarily something you would use on a production system, but it's more like when you're trying to experiment something, it gives you a history. But there are many other ways to give a history on those things. So I have a working system now. You see all of my services are running. And if I go to my same web client here, and I start the properties again, I hopefully have an SDL product as a field set up here. So that now happened within my recipe. Good. So did my recipe demo work? I think it did. So I didn't show you all of those advanced screens, but the same goes in the IIS, component services. So that could all happen, and this was the most basic recipe I could think of. So I showed you that. Again, software is layers, more and more layers, but that has to do, that's how we get to more, reduce the complexity by automating a lot of the stuff. But you can have even, like, you can think of markers on your file system that say, I'm spinning up this box because I want this box to become a new backend server to handle this and this. So you put a marker is a file in the C drive. And then your recipe reads that file and says like, I need to configure this box so that it runs background task. So that's your driver. So it's a matter on how you inject those things. And then for those who are aware of virtual machines or Amazon or Azure, there are ways to decide at spin up of a box which what the purpose of the box is. You can inject that stuff and your recipe can read those markers and act on that. So I'm not gonna show that, but there is a next level to this thing as well. So this was it for the deployment automation. Yeah. Next piece is business automation. So some concepts I will reiterate. We have a public SOAP web API that powers our client tools, but also is remote. We try to describe the function compatibility. So the table, like which versions is the function deprecated, what is its natural successor and all that. But there is also a technical compatibility. So that's the way you communicate. And ASMX is something else than WCF, but we offer most of those functions in the two technical ways. And if we would come up with a third way, introducing a REST API, then the functions will still be there, but the way you communicate, REST is different than ASMX or WCF as a protocol, but the business functions will still be there in a compatibility way. The logical version language, if you want to use the system and you want to know how you publish something or that, then you need to know these concepts. Because on every of these level, logical, version, and language, we store metadata in and have different metadata fields. All of the content objects, maps, topics, libraries, the others, publication outputs, they follow logical version language. There is another group which we call the single card types, and those are like user, user group, baseline, those as simple one card setups, but they still have the field notion and they will usually say level none instead of logical version language. The basics of Ish Remote is it respects the security paradigm. I think that's these days no longer a big surprise, but it knows how to talk to your STS and then gets the token and offers it to the web services. The most simple way of getting a new session, so it connects to your web services URL, passing some credentials. So that's the only two parameters. And yeah, as it said over in the third line here, in the past you would have to catch this in a ISH session parameter in the PowerShell language, but that's not even required anymore. You can just do the new session and we'll catch it in an implicit session for you. So that makes a lot of the examples a lot simpler and cleaner to read. So I don't know how I'm doing on time, but I'll do the demo now and give you hopefully quite a lot of inspiration. I'll share the script again. I have to check that my demo folder here is empty. So what happens here is an example of the administrator's upgrade. So all of those XML settings files, I can set up a new session and it will connect to my web services, and it'll now print some information like this is the version of each remote, and this is the version of the server. So this is a regular 14.0.0. And then these lines here, if I run those, then it actually retrieved all of the XML files from the database and stored them in my demo folder here. So you can easily take a backup that way. The next piece here is actually after database upgrade tool, this is a way to upload the new and changed files. So this is my customer specific files, files to copy, websites author enter via UE, which is the historical standard path for those XML settings. And you can read those files and push them in the set ISH setting commandlet. And it would just submit those in, and they are now in there and active. Second group of commandlets, which I think is nice to start playing with, is since version 13, I think, we offer a web service that allows you to retrieve the whole type and field setup from the repository, so even your custom fields. So it actually says for all of the types in the repository, these are our types, so let's say illustration, on the logical level, you have these fields. Those are linked with an LOV or date-time fields. They are, the S stands for system field, the D stands for descriptive, and the B for basic. It's a multi-value, it's a mandatory, and you can use it in create, read, update, and find operations. So this standard grid view, there are some fields that have passwords in there. Well, for those fields, we don't allow read operations. So that's kind of blocked. But that gives you an idea if you want to start develop against it and you want to see stuff, then this is definitely a way to check out what my repository looks like. There is also a compare commandlet, so you can test two environments. In the past, over here, it would have read parameter ISH session. That is gone. So you don't have to write this thing anymore and pass it along all the time. That has been removed in a more recent version of Ish Remote. LOVs, so that's the controlled list of values, permitted values that you can set up in the system. If I would get all values for the languages and the illustration types and the statuses, it will give you those. And it shows you also their element name, which is the more stable way of configuring stuff. Because this is the label and it can still be renamed. But with the element name, that no longer changes. Once it's created, it will remain that forever, even if you don't call it a diagram anymore, but call it something else. So for inspiration, if I would from the system retrieve everything where the data type is an LOV, and I would push that in a grid view, then these are all the permitted values in the system. So for languages, users, background tasks, these are all controlled lists that we have. Another one is EDT, which is short for electronic document types. So the system doesn't allow you to upload any file. You have to define electronic document type before you can upload those into the repository. And the system, this is my system, and these file types are allowed. As you can see, it has a lot nicer printing. So all of the basic fields are retrieved and immediately printed in a table, which gives you a lot nicer interaction. So one single commandlet gives you quite a lot of information about the system. And again, you can start thinking about automation. Talking about automation, while the above was more like checking out what's happening in the system, there is also a publishing commandlet. So where in this case I hard-coded that a certain GUI 10 version should be rendered for chum in English. So that commandlet exists. Now I'm not gonna wait till it's handled, but the status pending is what I'm looking for here, because I can now query for it as well, like which publications have, and this is the element name, vpub status published pending. And now I'm passing that to the find commandlet. And I made, actually I can do more indeed. I'm passing that to the find commandlet, which pipes it, so passes it again to the grid view, where I can do a manual selection, if I want to cancel them. So I got two of them in pending, and I can highlight the two of them and state okay. Then that selection will be passed to the stop commandlet, and they are now stopped, so their status got canceled. This was an example. Another example is if we start the publishing on something. I cooked this before, so it's already published, but you can imagine that we can also now retrieve it. So there is a get that retrieves a certain file, and I added it here in the demo folder. This is one, but I can also now state with a certain filter here for this publication across all versions, retrieve me the file. And now you will see it will retrieve all of those files and download them to the file system. So once you get them, you can push them in your document management system, do an action on them. So again, toolkits to make stuff happen. More in the monitoring category is since Tridion Docs 13 SP2, we have a couple of background task API calls added. So those will give you a view on the queue. And in this case, not a lot of it is running. So don't know if I can do that easily. I'm running a background task in console modus to hopefully give you something to show here. Okay, so here you see that the background task is picking up a publish action, it's executing on it, and it also took a lease on it, saying this is mine for a configurable expiration time, and I have to refresh it every time within that expiration time. Because if I don't refresh it, I would kill that background task process here. Then it could still be in the database, but another background task service will say like, this has not been touched since an hour. I will restart. So again, respecting our NFRs. Then ISH event. This is the web services API on what you see in the Content Manager Explorer as the event log. So there is in essence, event log is a centralized logging mechanism for all of those fire and forget operations. And this also gives you a view. By default, it will has a couple of filters on it's in the documentation, but you can filter that it gives you all users, only yourself. It can do modified since a certain date. So by default, most people are only interested in what happened in the last working day, so the last 24 hours. And that also means that you're not pulling many megabytes of information to this ish remote session. But yeah, this is a quick view on those publishing operations and on that logging. We also have, the most simple one, what is the version? So it answers that. There is a get time zone call. Oh, I made a typo here. There is a get time zone call, and that's actually a web service call that does a quick deep check to the database. So it checks from the remote, from ISH remote to the application server, and then from application server towards the database server if those connections are alive, and it gives you back that result. So it's a quick way to do a deep health check. There is a test session, and that can even do an ignore SSL policy. So in this case, I'm using HTTPS but localhost, which is not my good configured URL, but I stay local on the box, and I can do a session, and it checks if my password is good or bad, and it doesn't error out, it just says false. So that's how test commandlets are supposed to work. Something else, I'm not going to execute these, but for inspiration, we have a test commandlet where you can pass the catalog so that you can test if these XML files are actually valid according to that catalog file that we offer. We also, and it's more for our own usage, but I think it's nice to share it with you guys, we have a data generalization. So sometimes we get customer data that is in a specialized data task or whatever, and we can run a generalized to the level that we do have in our engineering databases. So that exists. And the same way, we also run obfuscation on that. And the best way to explain obfuscation is that we keep the whole data structure in place and all of the GUIDs and that. But everything, every word is replaced with an exact replacement. So every 8-letter word is replaced with zucchini. And then the whole mapping table. So if you have a lot of 8-letter words in your text, you get topics with zucchini, zucchini, zucchini. But it's the same content size. It's just obfuscated. That's stuff that we do. So if things are like that are shared, makes it easier to reproduce stuff. So that exists, and it can even do specific attributes if you want to. Users, this is the metadata to create a user. And then I'm gonna create that user in that last line here. So if I execute that, we get a new user. It's called Frank Demo. And I can test for Frank Demo with password demo, and it will say true. So that's a very simple way to add or synchronize your users. So I can now retrieve all of the users that have a name like Frank in their display name. So I do a find on those users, and I can show them in an output table. So if I run that, then I get several Franks. And if I only like, in this case, Frank Closet and Frank Girardi, I press OK. Then those are the only two that are passed in the selected users here. So if I quickly render selected users, then those are the only two passed. So I can now do selected users, and then in a standard commandlet, which is called export CSV file. But I think a nice one for you guys to know is there is another module, a PowerShell module, and it's called import Excel, which doesn't require Excel, but it can generate XSLX files. So it can generate the standard Excel files. So it knows how to work with the XML open document format. And the most simple way I can show it here is that those users, if I pass them to that commandlet, and in this case, it will just create the file and immediately start Excel, but you can also pass it to a file name, of course. And it will print all of the fields that are by default on the objects returned. So last change, use roles, departments, all that kind of stuff. So everything I showed, output format, EDT, setup, you can pass that to that export Excel, and then you can imagine that you can start your own custom reporting on it. So you can get it, filter it, and do custom reporting on it. And I think that's pretty powerful. There are also commandlets to loop through folder structures. So you always have to watch out a bit that you don't do a find and actually try to pull your whole database over the wire. So you have to think either you iterate using your folder structure or you iterate with a find operation, where the easiest one is to iterate on time frames. So you do a filter that says like everything modified in this week, the week before, the week before, the week before, and then you get simple deltas that the database can handle, and your memory will not explode, but you can get all of the data back. So this is iterating folders, so this is the system folder, and it contains also the other templates. So that's, and then from that, you have folders, and you can start retrieve folder items, and so on and so on. So this is the demo part. And the recap are just reference slides to see that I didn't forget anything. So we talked about the administrator's upgrade, getting all of the files on the file system, submitting them again, that you can get the setup of your database. And definitely if you start a program, that's something a lot of people find handy. Or if you need to configure stuff, that you can find the right spelling or values for all of those entries. Publishing and canceling, where below here I describe a bit which metadata we are retrieving. So in the past, I would only retrieve descripting metadata. These, since version 7, it's basic metadata, which is a lot more. It's all of the stuff you more or less would see in a property screen. And then if you want to see all of the stuff, so including the system fields, then you would specify all. But basic is the new default. Also in the past, we would not enrich the objects with read-only properties, but now we do, and that's why you get those nice grid views, easy exports to Excel, because it's all done for you. Publish and the download, yeah, I think that speaks for itself. The monitoring we did, as well from the queue point of view as the logging. Quick tests, version, the deep check to the database, obfuscation and generalization of Oasis data, creation of a user, so if you want to synchronize user profiles, a classic is also, of course, if users leave the company or joining the company, that you kind of immediately push that out into the system as well, that you get more stuff locked down. I think the nice export modules should get you inspired on doing some custom reports as well. So yeah, a bunch of categories that we covered. Most of it I showed only the find or the retrieve operations, but they all have their matching add and set commandlets as well, so that you can update stuff. So yeah, on both categories of automation, the deployment one as the business automation one, try something small. Try to work with it, and then you feel what you can do, what you want, what you like, and then it all becomes a little bit more predictable, because this can go up to file naming conventions, on downloading stuff. There is definitely possibilities there for you guys. So.